for Capital Recording Artist Tyrese.
Wow. That's the best hello, how are you? I heard it, man. All right,
So, Tyrese, how's it going, bro?
I'm all right, man. Just trying to wake up. Just trying to wake up, man. There's been a lot going on out here on the road. What's up, bro? How y'all doing?
I'm asking now, you know, you've so many great movies from Baby Boy, Transformers. Y'all know this goes on. Now, you know, they look at you as a bad boy, but even in the when you're doing your performances, you seem like even when you're a good guy, you're still a bad dude. Is that how does that work for you so far? As, you know, it's Tyrese.
Well, I just think the whole bad boy thing is really about, you know, growing up in South Central LA, growing up in the hood, and it's just certain energy that you can't help but become, you know what I'm saying? Like, when you're in the hood, you just kind of gotta have on that energy, or you're gonna get slapped around in the hood, you know what I'm saying? So between that energy right there and just, it's like you got that energy and then you got these teeth with a smile. As you know, so it's like, Is he threatening or is he happy? Is he cool? I like to create a balance, you know what I'm saying? It's just about having fun and being yourself.
Well, when you first came out, when you started out, when you did the commercial for Coca-Cola.
Yes, sir.
Did you ever suspect that you would be at this level as being an actor, doing your thing right now? Did you always think like...
No. You know, what's been unreal about my life, I know a lot of people can relate to this, it doesn't really matter what level of playing field we ultimately get to. What's been great about my life is none of this was expected. And so you got your plans and then you got God's plan. And so when it comes to God's plan, it's always keeping your spirit open to possibilities. And, you know, even last night while I was on stage, I always have those moments where I'm looking out in the crowd and they thinking that it's just a part of my show, but I'm really on stage in disbelief that everybody showed up for me and all of this energy is out here. It's unreal, and I hope I never get used to it.
That's
it. Tyrese, why don't you tell us about your album? Tell us about it. We of course on V101.5, we're playing Stay. Love the record. Did y'all love that record?
Yes.
Stay. It has like that old school feel to it. Tell us about the record and your CD.
Well, what I like to do musically is I got kind of a long and a short answer on that. Musically, I try my best to do things that I think would be timeless. Because you got a lot of records that are really, really hot right now. But then, if you ask a DJ or an on-air personality which records was hot 6 months ago, they're gonna forget. And so, you know, you got records that are like the Sprint, and then you got marathon records, the ones that stay around and run its course. And it's been 5 years since I dropped an album. And for a lot of political reasons that I won't go into, I just felt like ultimately I just needed more control on my career. Because I love music so much and it's my first and only love. But yet, when you're at a major label, so to speak, you go in the studio, you work your ass off on something, and then you pass it off to the executives and you hope that they decide to get behind it. But when you do it independent, like I did this time with Open Invitation, you don't have to worry about getting behind yourself. Because you know you're going to show up for yourself and you're going to present your best foot forward. And so everything means everything. It means way more than it's ever meant. Every radio spin, the fact that y'all are here right now, y'all may be a fan from back in the day or right now, but the fact that y'all are here and this, the focus is about the new album, Open Invitation, everything just means more because I did it on my own. I did this album at home, literally. So it's a big deal, and I'm just happy to be back in music.
Well, we're glad you're back, right? You were recently on our program director's call for Clear Channel, not too long ago, and we were talking about your music, and I was the one that started talking about your book. And in case you all have not read this book, How to Get Out of Your Own Way, this is amazing. I was really impressed by this book, and I was just impressed by, you know, the openness that you had, you know, because some people write books, but they don't really want to tell their story. Mm-hmm. So tell us, how did this come about, and why did you feel compelled to be so open about your life?
Well, we're amongst the lost generation, and they love to say that the lost is the teenagers and the youngsters running around, shooting and killing, thugging, banging, sexing, pregnanting. Yeah, I made that word up. But you know, it's I just feel like I don't know what's been going on with me lately for these last couple of years, but I feel a certain responsibility to make people aware of things that they may not know. And so it's not from a preacher's perspective, like trying to become a pastor. I don't really know if that's my call, and if it is, then I'll take it. But I just think ultimately, if people are going to show up everywhere I go, then it's one thing to show up and do the photo ops and sign autographs and get your screens, and it's another thing to say, you were not thinking about these things before we met up and had a conversation about it. And if anybody else has said these exact things, just maybe it may not impact you as much as it would coming from me. So I feel a certain responsibility to put things on people's minds and have it to come from me. And so pertaining to that book, a lot of people are in their own way. It's not woman specific, you know. A lot of people are in their own way and they don't know it. You know, what is your interpretation of love? Why do you keep on going after the same men? Why did you decide that that's the man that I'm supposed to be with? Why did you decide that that's the woman I'm supposed to be with? Who we are as adults is a direct reflection of our childhood. And so just maybe that man reminds you of the man that your mother was in a relationship with. That can be a good thing or a bad thing because we're all used to patterns. And so all of this goes back to, why am I more comfortable with working for somebody versus for myself? All of these things are patterns. If your father's the CEO, he's in the real estate and he's used to having his own and creating his own, then you grow up in that environment. You can't grow up and feel comfortable with getting a job and working for somebody when you watched your mother and father run their own businesses, have their own, create their own. So you become a product of your environment. And so getting out of your own way goes back to just saying, okay, well, yes, I grew up in this environment. I was exposed to this. I'm used to this. But I want to get out of my own way and go and create my own destiny. I decided I want to do and be better than my mother and father. I don't represent the success of anybody in my family. There's nobody that was able to achieve this type of success in my family. Because I decided I don't want that. I don't want anything to do with what y'all did. I'm cool. You still gonna be my mama, but I'm cool. That ain't for me. And so it takes somebody to recognize that they're an individual. I wasn't born a Siamese twin. It's about recognizing this is your individual path. This is who you are. My mind is not connected to your mind. I don't have to dress like you. I don't have to look like you. I don't have to wear my hair like you. I don't have to live my life according to your comfort zone. Why are you doing that? Why are you over there hanging? Come on over here with us, man. Why are you all over there doing all of these ways? The translation of that is, come be like us. Come think like us. Why are you over there thinking like that? Well, you know, I drive what I drive. I live the way I live because I decided that I don't want to be like nobody else. That's it.
Can I get an amen?
Amen.
My two biggest takeaways from that book was, we are a product of what our childhood was.
Absolutely.
And if you think about that, that's so true. The second takeaway is when you were talking about you and your mom, I think you all were in the pool, and she was describing her mother, and you were thinking to yourself, you're describing you. And I had that same situation that happened with me and my mother. And that was so deep when
you
I
really read the book.
Yes, I really read the book. So how did you feel when that moment happened? I mean, I know how I felt. I was kind of like, do you realize you're talking about yourself?
Oh, my God.
How did you feel?
Well, I don't want to give it all away. But just in case some of y'all decide to get the book or not, I'll just share this story. Basically, one night, because I'm not really close to my mother. Wish I was, but I'm not. 27 years of alcohol abuse. The version of my mother that I experienced because of the alcohol wasn't quite the mother that I was hoping for. Because, you know, drugs and alcohol abuse can bring other personalities and characteristics. So am I really supposed to love you as the version of my mama that showed up? You know, I don't really know who you are because you're drunk all the time. So it is what it is. It created the character and the man that I am because I experienced that. But because I'm not close to my mom, I don't get to see her as often. Because a lot of those same memories really mess me up. And I've been praying on it, you know, because you carry that around you. Doesn't matter what kind of money you make, that, you know, it's still in you and that feeling. So one night, reached out to my mom's, and we was in a jacuzzi at my boy's crib. Don't think that it's not like that. Just in the jacuzzi, she was like, I don't like to swim. I don't like, you know, swimming pools, because my mama tried to drown me when I was young. I was like, wow. She like, yeah. I got pregnant with your sister when I was 16. And so my mama was ashamed of that, because back in the day, having a pregnant teenager as a child is embarrassing. So she tried to drown me while I was pregnant with your sister. I was like, damn. So she's like, I don't like swimming pools because of that. I was like, so let's get in the jacuzzi, mom. It's all good, let's hang out. She's like, okay, cool. It ain't deep, is it? I said, no. So we in the jacuzzi, and it was a full moon out. It was nighttime. We had a view of the city, it's beautiful. And I just decided tonight, I want to ask my mama some questions that I've never asked her before, and I encourage y'all to do the same thing. I said, Mama, where were you when you conceived me? I was the only child of four that was born in L.A. I was born in Martin Luther King Hospital in 78 Watts, South Central. December 30th. Absolutely. I love you for that. I'm Capricorn season. You know what I mean? So I said to my mama, where did you conceive me? She said, she's like, me and your dad made you when I was in St. Louis. Because all my brothers and sisters were born in St. Louis. And she said, I knew I was pregnant. I was the last child of four. She said, I knew I was pregnant because I already had three kids before you. So I just knew when me and your dad made you that you was on the way. And she said, your daddy call himself trying to chase a music career. So he was like, let's move to LA. My daddy sings, you know, he cool. But he was like, let's move to LA. So he just uprooted and decided to move to LA. Long story short, my mother's mother was an alcoholic, still is an alcoholic. Had all these boyfriends randomly living in the house. Mental, spiritual, emotional, dysfunctional abuse all across the board. Everything that I experienced when I was growing up in my house. So then I just started asking my mama, please explain to me what your childhood was like. And so she goes in all of these details about everything that she was exposed to as a child. And then I'm listening to my mama explain all of this. And while she was explaining it, she had no idea that she was explaining to me the way she raised us. She never even connected her mother to being her, as if it was separate. Like she's literally, yeah, all these boyfriends was coming in our house. I used to hate that. They were drinking, talking to us, and treating us, and abusing us, and doing all this. And my mama used to put her boyfriends over us and made us feel like we didn't even matter when they came around. It was just crazy. And she's explaining, you know, and I'll spare y'all all the details. It's all in the book. But she's going on and on and on and on and on about these boyfriends and just the experience of her growing up. And so I realized at that very moment that my mother raised us the best way she knew how, because she did exactly what her mother did to us. And she wasn't even aware of it. She was a part of the cycle. She didn't have it in her to break the cycle. She didn't decide, my family and my mother raised me this way, so I'm not going to raise my kids that way. She didn't decide that because she wasn't even aware of it. And so at that point, I forgave my mother. Not all the way, because I'm still dealing with my challenges, but I forgave my mother in a sense of, you just didn't know no better. You didn't know that you were raising us the way you were raised. And so it made me understand the pattern. And I can't get away from what I experienced because I experienced it. But it made me understand that she was just a product of her environment. And I was on the receiving end of her cycle. So it was a powerful moment. And I put it in the book. Bless you. Some people feel like if I'm not on TV, I'm not valuable. It's not in everybody's cards to be on television. I'm telling you, I swear, I love all of the perks and all of the energy that comes with being Tyrese. I can't lie. It was in my cards to be who I am. But I have those moments where I wish I was the man right there in the back, program director, boss. You know, he drive, he live the life he live. He's in his car, he's living the life, he's got his house, his money, his cars, his family. He's able to walk in the mall, shop, enjoy himself without people gawking, looking, sneaking, little pitching, I see your ass film. Thank you, Slick. I be telling my security this sometime. When you walk in, that's my security. Say what's up to Gerald, y'all. 12 years, my guy right there. Legendary. Yeah, all he do is fight women off. He ain't doing no real security. Nobody after me. Keep telling, man, you're only pushing off women. Lose some weight, man. You ain't got to get that big just push women off. Get back. No photos. What are you doing? I said get back. Leave him alone. It's crazy. 12 years. Easiest money on earth. So sometimes we be in the mall, at the airport. I'm waking up now. Be at the airport. And you'll just see people standing up and shit. They think they slick. They can act as if I know, thinking that they checking text messages. You ain't checking no text messages like this right here.
kind of text message are you sending like this? And then they want to look around as if they're not filming. Get your ass out of here.
Tyrese, we got two more questions. We're okay, let's go.
Hi, Tyrese. My name is Monisha. My name is
What's
Monisha.
Up, Monisha?
My question is, with your childhood and growing up, and what you say your mom took you through the challenges, when you played Jody and Baby Boy in the scenes you did with your mom in the movie with her boyfriend, did you feel like a special connection with that?
Oh, absolutely. Crazy thing is, I had nothing to do with writing that movie, but I wasn't acting in Baby Boy. That was my life on film, I swear. That was my life on film. You know what's crazy, right? I ain't never shared this story. One time on the set, remember that scene in the living room when me and Ving Rhames got in a fight and he ended up socking me and I fell on the table and shit. Whatever. I was alright, you know what I'm saying? I took it like a mat. It's nothing. Whatever. I'm wipe your chin off, remember? So after he hit me and I fell back, before we got physical, it was a scene that I was struggling with because, you know, for me, everything I do, if it doesn't come from a real place, I feel like people are not going to connect to it. So there was this one scene when I walked up to Ving, and I was like, cuz, I got heat for niggas like you. It wasn't coming from a real place because I did the scene a bunch of times. And then he was like, he said something, I forgot the exact line. Me and your mama, da 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 da, he was saying that, and I wasn't getting mad enough. So Ving went off and he asked John Singleton what my mama's name was. Right? And so he said, me and Priscilla. So, you know, at that point I wasn't acting because he said my mama's name, so you know, it became real. But yeah, it's I absolutely could relate to the movie, and that's why so many people can identify with the movie, because it came from a real place.
Renee, and I'm here with the meet and greet for Tyrese. The show is absolutely wonderful. He's very, you know, down to earth, very real, and that's one thing I do like about Tyrese.
I felt like prior to coming, I just like saw the Tyrese from the movies and the music, but after hearing him speak, I was like so inspired, because these are things that he was saying that I was told, like breaking away from my family and stuff, so I just got real inspired today. So that was my favorite part, that he was real enough to speak to us, give us more than just the Jody and all that. So.
Thank you, 93.3B and B101.5, for allowing me to attend this luncheon with Tyrese. It was amazing. He is so real. I enjoyed spending the hour with him and seeing him last night in concert. And thank you again, and I love you, Tyrese.
Would hurt.